job, Mr. Mayweather. Straight and steady. Let's go.
And welcome once again to As the Reel Turns, your place for all things movie and television. We've got a really fun show for you. We are starting our summer series. Now, if you remember last time, we did the Summer of James Bond to celebrate his 60th anniversary. And that was our last big summer thing. But now, I figured, you know, before we go, you know, we don't know how long the show's going to last. So I thought we might as well get it out of the way because people ask about it a lot. This entire summer, we are devoting to the beloved science fiction franchise, Star Trek. Yes, Star Trek, celebrating 58 years this year, so we're almost to 60. And we're going to go through as much Star Trek as we possibly can. And this time, in June, we're going to do part one, as you saw there. We're going to do the classic Star Trek, as it's called. All the series that came up to the year 2005. And I've got some great Star Trek fans to talk about it with. We got my friend and fellow coworker, Joe, and my friend and former coworker, Timothy. Guys, thanks for coming on.
Yeah. We didn't scare you away last time.
No, you didn't. Okay. No.
We'll have to try harder.
Exactly. Yeah. Well, I hope not. So I appreciate you guys coming on the show. And we are going to jump right into Star Trek. And, you know, for people out there who don't know what Star Trek is, turn off your televisions now and stop watching, because you shouldn't be watching this. Unless you want to be converted, which is our goal.
If you don't know what Star Trek is,
you should be watching.
The truth.
Yeah. I mean, after all.
Contact the UN, the US government. You've obviously, you're from another planet.
Better yet, stay away from the government.
That's right. So, during this time, around season six or seven, there was crossover. Now, people always say, well, Next Generation is the spinoff of the original. No, it's not. If you want to say there was ever a Star Trek spinoff, this next one is the spinoff. This is starting in 1993, Star Trek Deep Space Nine. So by this time, we've sadly lost Gene Roddenberry. And so a new showrunner has kind of picked up the torch there by the name Rick Berman. He's kind of the new Roddenberry, in quotes.
And he was closely involved in the movies, correct?
Yes, yeah. I think he was, yes. And so Rick Berman asked Roddenberry to basically give his blessing on this next show, which he basically said, we're not doing a ship, we're doing a space station. okay, what happened to boldly going where no man's gone before? But anyway, Deep Space Nine starts out basically as a single station on the edge of the final frontier, as they called it, right near a wormhole to another quadrant of space. And we have a great cast here, compiling of Avery Brooks, woo, New Jersey. We have
Rene Auberjonois
as Odo, a shapeshifter. There's your spinoff. Worf comes back,
but not till season three,
four. Yeah. We have some really new, interesting characters like Terry Farrell's Dax. This is the first time we see a captain and his son, a child, Jake Sisko. There's your other spin-off connection. A transporter chief now is the new engineer, Colm Meaney's Miles O'Brien. Good Irishman there. Quark is a Ferengi, big ear guy, a bit of a swindler. That was a name change. Sitting El Fidel, who became Alexander Siddig as Dr. Bashir, and then Major Kira as our Bajoran kind of first officer, in a way, to this of this show. And of course, you see that they finally did boldly go. They have a ship called the Defiant. Many people are afraid of this show because they see it as this is the Star Trek war show. Because a lot of themes in this got a little darker. Mm-hmm. They were more drawn out. They had like season long arcs. Mm-hmm. Then, like I just said, we have a war going on between the Federation and a group of aliens called the Dominion, which are comprised of various different species. There's a bit of like a Holocaust look between the Bajorans and their previous occupants, the Cardassians.
Do you know how many Bajorans the Cardassians murdered during the occupation? Over 10 million.
I take it then you witnessed the atrocities.
Atrocities? What atrocities?
You expect me to believe you knew nothing of the murders, the tortures. You never saw the bodies.
Of course I saw bodies. People died all the time at Gallatin. Mining accidents, illnesses, feuds among the workers.
They were children, Doctor. None of them were older than 14 years old. They knew nothing. They lived in bound-out rooms, scrounged for food on the streets. They were filthy and they stank.
The conditions were harsh. It was a labor camp, Major.
I helped liberate that camp. I saw the bodies. I know how they died.
Courtesy of our prefect, Gul Dukat.
But I did. I did to make Cardassia strong again.
Now there was a leader. Brilliant, extraordinary man. He knew that to rule by fear was to rule completely.
I should have completed my interrogation and turned them over to the troop for execution.
My regrets was law. And the verdict was always the same. Guilty.
Jorns were a peaceful people before you came. We offered no threat to you. We could never understand why you had to be so brutal.
We had an empire to protect. We needed your resources. Everything I did was for the glory of Cardassia.
And not the Cardassians, the Cardassians. All this stuff going on, and it was all put by showrunner Ira Stephen Baer, who, fun fact, was the showrunner for Fame for a season. Oh. So weird to go from a high school musical show to Star Trek. But Timothy, we'll go to you first. Star Trek Deep Space Nine, was it a wise decision to make it a singular space station? And as an overview, what do you think of DS9?
It's another one that if you're used to the first two shows, mm-hmm. it takes a little bit of getting used to.
Yep.
I don't actually know, but I think he wanted to get off a ship to avoid comparisons to the first two shows.
Sure. This is Berman.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And he also took a lot of their tech away, because when the Cardassians left Bajor,
yeah.
they stripped the station.
Of course.
This was originally a Cardassian station.
Yeah.
And it's also not Federation territory. It is Bajoran territory. The Federation is just there to, quote, help the Bajorans get back on their feet after their war.
And the Bajorans are definitely an allegory to the Jews.
Yeah, and they explore some new themes. They get far more into religion than the previous shows
did. That they do, yes.
Far more.
Yep.
both the positive and negative aspects mm-hmm. of religion. When the Dominion War comes up, a lot of the stories revolve around a question of can you fight a war and still preserve your soul, the sure. essence of who you are?
Sure.
And there are a couple of episodes that go really into that.
Well, we open with Ben Sisko having flashbacks kind of to mm-hmm. when Picard was Locutus, because he hates Picard now, because he, because of the Borg fight, Sisko's wife dies.
Yes.
So there's...
In his mind, Picard killed his wife.
Exactly. So all this stuff just happens mm-hmm. right away.
Yeah. And there's one great scene, I don't know, I think it's first season, maybe second season. Mm-hmm. Q shows up on DS9, and they take the opportunity to really throw in people's face that this is not any of the previous shows, because, you know, Sisko hauls off and gives him a right cross across the jaw.
Yes.
I forget if he knocks him down.
Yeah.
But Q looks at him and says, "You hit me. Picard never hits me." And he looks at him, he says, "I'm not Picard."
"This is an excellent idea. Sisko to us. All gone. Bring them back, Q. Now!
Or what? You'll thrash me? Shall we settle this mano a mano?"
"Marcus of Queensberry rules!
What?
Fisticuffs, pugilism, the manly art of self-defense! Come on! Isn't this all wonderfully barbaric? Go on, take a poke at me! I know that's what you really want to do! Go on!
I'll wager 5 bars of Latinum on Sisko.
You're on.
Fight back! This is supposed to be brutal!
You can pay me out of your profits from the auction."
"You hit me. Picard never hit me.
I'm not Picard."
"Indeed not. You're much easier to provoke. How fortunate for me."
Which I love. And, you know, there are some cheesy episodes in those first couple seasons.
Yeah.
Like, I know.
And later,
yeah. Like, I remember one where they, four of them are transported into, like, a game, and they're playing
yes.
pieces. That one's a little silly, but.
Watch this.
Elma Rain, then three more. Elma Rain, count to four. Elma Rain, then three more. Elma Rain, if you can see. Elma Rain, you come with me.
But I did everything she did.
No, Julian, you didn't.
I followed her footsteps. Exactly.
But you didn't say the rhyme.
Alma Rain, count to four. Alma Rain, then three more. Alma Rain, if you can see. Alma Rain, you'll come with me.
Come on, just say the rhyme.
Alma Rain, then three more. Alma Rain, if you can see. Alma Rain, you'll come with me.
Elma Rain, count to four. Elma Rain, count to four.
But Joe, I mean, like, DS9 did try to rekindle some stuff that, although Next Generation is peak Star Trek, maybe, DS9 tried to bring back some stuff. Like, we had a lot of episodes in the Mirror Universe.
Energize.
Where are we?
I guess you could say we just stepped through the looking glass.
You are me, aren't you?
I'm Kira Nerys. That makes two of us. Are you the leader of this sector or not?
You know how to manipulate me.
I know how I'd feel in your place.
I heard you were back. That's for making love to me under false pretenses. I was suspicious of you from the start.
You hit it well.
If you ever touch me again. Do you get my point?
I hope not.
What happened?
You remember the intendant, don't you? I was taking her to an interrogation session when the vile little tyrant tried to escape.
Business.
But perhaps it would be prudent to increase our speed to warp 9.
What?
I was merely trying to be of service.
If it was not for your incompetence, the rebels would have been destroyed.
And we had kind of this ongoing romance between Odo and Kira.
Odo, wait.
Major, if you don't mind, I'd like to forget all about last night.
I don't think that's a good idea. We need to talk about what happened.
Very well, then we can meet in my office in an hour.
Well, let's discuss it over dinner.
Dinner?
Yeah, you can choose the restaurant, anywhere but a holosuite.
What about Shakar? Do you think he'll approve?
Look, I don't care whether he approves or not. Shakar and I are friends. That's all, friends. The First Minister asked me to update him on the war with the Dominion. My visit was strictly business. Now, are we going to have dinner together or not?
And if we do, then what?
I don't know. Maybe we could go dancing.
And after that, I suppose you'll expect me to kiss you.
Well, it's possible.
But then who needs dinner? Why don't I just get it over with and kiss you right now?
Well, why don't you?
And one of my favorite characters of all time, this holodeck program, Vic Fontaine, who's like a 60s singer in
Vegas.
Vegas lounge singer, yeah.
Now that's more like it. Captain, can you join me?
Out of the tree of life, I just picked me a plum. You came along and everything started to hum. Still, it's a real good bet, the best is yet to come.
But then, and bringing on next generation crew members like O'Brien and Worf, What do you think of DS9?
I didn't hate the series, let's put it that way.
I get that a lot.
I won't say that I was a hardcore fan either, but you brought up some good points.
Yeah.
I mean, I thoroughly enjoyed, and I was really disappointed that in the earlier two series there weren't more to do with the mirror universes.
Right.
I mean, I thoroughly enjoyed the thinking of the mirror universes, and I love to see what the writers did with the mirror universes.
Right. Because this is later on in the years, they could do a lot more violence and stuff like that.
Oh, sure.
Yeah.
And the thing was, your point is taken about the fact that they did have to do, well, basically more with less.
Yeah.
I remember some of them O'Brien freaking out because things were constantly breaking
down on
the station, and he had to figure out how to fix them. Kind of like that generation Scotty. It's just like, you know, here we go, we're coming apart, and I got to fix it with what? You know, I mean.
Trade a Scotsman for an Irishman.
Yeah, exactly. You know, I mean, and it's just as amusing in its own right.
I mean,
because, you know, I mean.
We seem to be having a lot of system glitches.
Happens every time Chief O'Brien goes away.
I do not understand why his staff cannot keep the station running in his absence.
There's no, you know, we got, you know, I'm giving it all we got, and he's just sitting there going, I got nothing. What do I do? You know, what do you want? You know,
right.
I
will say that Sisko did go through two different looks. Avery Brooks came off a show called Spencer for Hire, and then his spinoff Man Called Hawk, and his first look is hair on top, no hair on face, and then easily, like, I don't know, three or four, hair on face, no hair on top, which I like the second look better. That's just a me thing. But no, I mean, we also have, like I mentioned, O'Brien and Worf from Next Gen. O'Brien's wife Keiko is in there too. And I don't recall like a lot of other Next Gen connections, but I think O'Brien mentioned something, Worf mentioned something. And then, of course, Worf's marriage to Dax.
Yeah, and Luoxana Troi.
Oh, yes, she does come.
Yeah.
Deanna's mother.
And DS9 pretty much completes Worf's storyline as a character.
Yep.
Not 100%. We don't know what happens to him afterward, but it really wraps up a lot of things. We see his brother again.
Yep.
I forget if he at least references Alexander.
Alexander is in there somewhere. Yeah. But the marriage between him and Jadzia Dax was huge.
Yeah.
And then, like you've been saying, no spoilers, we lose Jadzia because Terry Farrell wanted to go on to bigger and better things.
Mor, son of Morg, does your heart beat only for this woman?
Yes.
And will you swear to join with her and stand with her against all who oppose you?
I swear.
Jadzia, daughter of Kayla, does your heart beat only for this man?
Yes.
And do you swear to join with him and stand with him against all who would oppose you?
I swear.
Then let all present here today know that this man and this woman are married.
Ducat.
Now, in the seventh season, we get a new Dax, because Dax is kind of like the Doctor. There's a symbiote inside a host, and the symbiote is transported to another host. So it's kind of like regeneration.
Yeah.
But we get Ezri Dax, played by Nicole DeBoer. And I want to say, she is the character and actress I feel the most sorry for in all of Star Trek, because...
More than Will Wheaton. Okay.
Because here she is... for one singular season and never appears again.
I can't believe it.
I can hardly believe it myself, but I'm Dax. I mean, I'm not Jadzia Dax, I'm Ezri Dax. But I have all of Jadzia's memories, not to mention Leela's, Tobin's, Emini's, Audred's, Joran's, Curzon's. Am I forgetting anyone?
Darius.
Right. You're probably asking yourself, who is this person? How did she get the symbiont? Do I even want another Dax in my life? Does she always talk this much? These are all very good questions, and I wish I had good answers for you.
The answers can wait. Right now, I'm just glad to see you.
Really? That is so nice of you to say. I'm not usually this emotional. It must be the Emini in me. At least I think it's Emini. Hi, Jake.
Hi.
You seem taller. Or am I shorter?
The actress is never seen again. The character is never seen again. And so in this wave of new Trek that we're in now, I'd say, like, this is a perfect time to bring her back.
Or at least to bring back a Dax.
A Dax, at least, yeah.
Yeah.
That's what I would say. But, there are so many other good characters, like Garrick the Tailor.
Mm.
He's great.
A lot of people probably don't know Andrew
Robinson,
film buffs. He is the serial killer from the original Dirty Harry movie.
Oh, okay. Okay,
yeah.
I didn't know that. But there's also a great salute to the original series where they combine the Tribbles episode with their own footage, and they bring back one of the original Klingons and all the... A lot of the original Klingons they bring back.
Almost all of them.
All of them.
Yeah.
So it's great stuff. And
fine. But I can't wait to get back to Deep Space Nine and see your face when you find out that I never existed.
Dax and I resumed our search for Darvin.
Benjamin Locke.
Bridge to Captain Kirk.
Okay.
The Barris is waiting on Channel 8 to speak to you, sir.
Keep working. We're a maintenance crew just doing our job.
Mr. Barris is coming on.
Yes, Mr. Barris, what can I do for you?
Kirk, this station is swarming with Klingons.
I was not aware, Mr. Barris, that 12 Klingons constitutes a swarm.
Klingons?
Over there? And over there?
Those are Klingons?
All right. You boys have had enough.
They are Klingons. And it is a long story.
Who started the fight?
I don't know, sir.
All right. Chekhov. I know you. You started it, didn't you?
No, sir, I didn't.
Well, who did?
And In the Pale Moonlight is a great, kind of like, almost like a play almost, because Sisko is narrating throughout the whole episode and talking straight to the camera. But I will say real quick, I'm going to be the black sheep here. DS9's finale is one of my favorite top two Star Trek finales. I know what you're thinking. But they don't sum up everything. They leave Sisko with the prophets. They don't do anything. Terry Farrell's not in it. This is all true. But they at least try to say goodbye. The fans and viewers who are watching, they try to say goodbye to you by giving you memories and giving you flashbacks. And that final pullout shot of the station, it's a goodbye. All you need is the word goodbye in rocks from MASH. That's all you need. But yeah, that's Deep Space Nine. If you're questioning it because it's stationary, give it a watch because it is good. There's a lot of story arcs involved. There's a lot of fun, especially with the Ferengis. They have a lot of fun. Max Gridencheck, if you're watching, you are still a good fan, a good friend of mine. I got to meet him at a convention, and he got to sit with me. And then years later, we saw each other again, and he remembered me. Super nice guy. And the Grand Nagus, Wallace Shawn. That's all I'm gonna say. So
from Princess Bride.
Princess Bride and dozens of other things. So yes, Deep Space Nine, give it a watch. You're not going to be that disappointed, I don't think, because it is good.
A lot of kick for a 45 dom.
Thank you, Mr.
Bashir. Julian Bashir.
Again, this was during the time where we're kind of crossing over with things. So in Deep Space Nine's final year or something like that, a ship literally undocked from DS9 and went on their own journey and got lost. This is...
Some people say they wish they had stayed lost.
That's true. This is Star Trek Voyager. All right, so the common joke here is that leave it to the woman captain to get you lost. No, kidding. That's the old joke. But anyway, yes, Star Trek Voyager. That's the plot of this show, is are we home yet? Because Voyager goes on their way to just boldly go once again, and they're flown miles and miles away, or light years, or whatever.
Parsecs.
Parsecs, sure. To an unknown unknown quadrant of space, the Delta Quadrant.
They're far enough away that at maximum warp, it would have taken them 75 years to get home.
Yes, that's right, yes. Yeah. And then that's basically the show. It's they're the new explorers of this unknown, undiscovered quadrant. All they know is that this is the quadrant that's home to the Borg. We've talked about them with Locutus and stuff like that. So we got some great cast members here. We got Robert Picardo as the holographic doctor because their actual doctor gets killed. We'll get to you, Jerry Ryan. we'll get to you. But the Eternal Ensign Harry Kim, a American Indian first officer and a friend of his, B'Elanna Torres, who were members of the defective Maquis who joined this crew. And then, of course, our female captain, Captain Catherine Janeway, who...
Kate Mulgrew had quite a career before.
Yes, she had. Yeah, Mrs. Columbo.
Amongst
others.
Rima Williams.
Yes.
She was in Rima Williams. Mm-hmm.
And she had like stints on Murder, She Wrote, Cheers, stuff like that. Voyager gets, I think, a lot of flack because how many more times can we say, are we home yet? Are we home yet? And this show lasted 7 seasons. So, you know, you're a little short on your 75 years to get home, but there were some good times in this show. I mean, we have a lot of character development with the Doctor. The Doctor's kind of our new Data, trying to be human a little bit. We have some character changes. First, we start out with Kes, played by Jennifer Lynn, who...
Doctor, I know that you care about me and that you have my best interests at heart. But everyone seems to be treating me like I'm still a child. I'm 3 years old now. If I'm attracted to someone, it's my business, not the whole ship's.
Who I found more attractive than her successor, ex-Borg 7 of 9, played by Jerry Ryan, who was...
I speak for the Borg.
I'm Captain Janeway. This is Lieutenant Tuvok.
We are aware of your designations.
What's your designation?
7 of 9, tertiary adjunct of Unimatrix 01. But you may call me 7 of 9. You are proposing a large-scale weapon. We concur.
I thought you might.
We could encase the nanoprobes in some of our photon torpedoes. In essence, turn them into biomolecular warheads.
Your torpedoes are inadequate. They lack the necessary range and dispersive force.
Do you have a better idea?
We are Borg.
We all know, be honest, was there just for eye candy. We all know that.
We've said before, I am here as an apologist. I like to explain why anything deserves to exist.
Right.
I have to say, it is an uphill slog with Voyager.
Tell us about Voyager.
Yeah. That being said, I like Voyager.
Yes, okay? I do too.
And yes, I agree. Jerry Ryan came on, like you said, to be the eye candy.
Keep still, please.
Anything you say, Doctor.
Mm-hmm. But she made more of the role than that.
That's true.
And I think Jennifer Lean, Kes, I think she left the show.
Speed, 1/4 impulse.
Can you hail her?
I've been trying.
It's happening. It's happening to me.
Her atomic structure is completely destabilizing.
I give to you.
And got in trouble.
Yeah, but she, her character, they found out, wasn't necessary. They didn't need her.
But alongside Kes, we also have Neelix.
Yes.
There's Neelix right there. There he is. Ethan Phillips, who appeared in many different Star Trek things, mm-hmm. not just as Neelix, but he's their guide, basically.
Yeah.
They meet him in the first episode, and he says, well, I can show you around, basically, and I can try to get you home and tell you to stay away from certain people and to contact others and stuff like that. But Joe, we'll go to you now. What are your thoughts on poor old Star Trek Voyager.
I'm not going to be an apologist here. I'm going here to be very quick and to the point.
Okay.
Okay. I saw very few episodes of Voyager.
Yep.
Not a fan.
Not a fan.
Not a fan at all. And I'm going to put part of the reason on that on Kate Mulgrew, because I thought she was horrible as a ship's captain. I don't know. It just didn't work for me. I will say that some of the episodes I did watch, I was okay with. But honestly, I did not go the whole seven seasons. I managed to see the initial one where they got bounced out of the quadrant and into the next one.
Yep.
And then I watched two of the shows after that, and I'm like, this isn't for me. I shouldn't say it's a bad show. I should say that it wasn't for me.
Well, see, For Kate Mulgrew, I will say quickly that I'm going to get the chance to hopefully meet her at the Boston Fan Expo. Miss Mulgrew, be there. And from the day I started watching Voyager when I was a little kid, I actually always said, wow, I have a thing for Kate Mulgrew. I had a huge crush on her. But I always joke, like, there were three hairdos she had. She had the bun, the ponytail, and the down. And it just went from bad, better... Now you're talking.
And she became a better captain after she cut her hair.
Yes. She really did. But there are some great episodes. I mean, like, you know, Year of Hell is a huge one.
The ultimate weapon. We have all eternity to accomplish our mission.
Does not destroy.
Captain, there's a spatial distortion heading toward us.
It erases.
All organisms and man-made objects have been eradicated.
Now, Voyager gets caught in the crossfire.
All hands brace for impact.
Can a device that alters time ever be destroyed?
It's trying to erase us from history.
On the next Star Trek Voyager. One man has the power to destroy the universe.
The destinies of countless star systems are in my hands.
And to resurrect it.
Thousands of worlds, billions of lives, gone, brought back, gone again.
Now, stopping a weapon that controls history.
Trying to rationalize genocide.
Comes down to one moment.
Prepare for total erasure.
We're only gonna have one chance.
On the next Star Trek Voyager.
We have some very funny episodes with Neelix and Tuvok, Tim Russ, with like riddles and Tuvix.
Mr. Vol.
Tuvok's race is known for being logical, emotionless. But Wednesday, he's out of his Vulcan mind.
Here we are, a triple chocolate wiki fruit sundae.
That is delicious.
An all-new Star Trek Voyager.
Got a much better sense of humor now.
Logical nightmare.
I'm only getting one pattern.
Merges Tuvok and Neelix together.
They're gone.
But when the two become one...
What point did he become an individual and not a transporter accident?
The result is unpredictable.
Are Neelix and Tuvok inside of you?
And the only option left...
We've created a monster.
...is unacceptable.
Are you going to stand by and do nothing while she commits murder?
On the next Star Trek Voyager...
Mr. Vulcan. So good to see you, Mr. Vulcan. One of my personal favorites is Tinker Tenor Dr. Spy, where the doctor he's daydreaming, basically, and has all these silly...
Experiment is turning fantasy into reality.
I couldn't bear to be alone.
And everyone...
A neurochemical imbalance is driving him to mate.
Have a look.
...is feeling the effects...
Right there.
An all-new Voyager.
La donna è mobile, qual più mal vento, muta d'accento e di pensiero. Sempre un amabile, leggiadro viso, in pianto, in riso e menzognero. La donna è mobile, qual più mal vento, muta d'accento.
Tuvok.
Janeway to security. Get a team to the mess hall right away.
Stand back. He's been seized by the Pon Farr. A neurochemical imbalance is driving him to mate. We won't be able to reason with him.
Tuvok, I understand. You are a Vulcan man. You have just gone without for 7 years about. Paris, please find a way to load a hypospray. I will give you the sign. Just aim for his behind. Hormones are raging. Synapses blazing. It's all so bad.
And then, yes, the cast hated them, but I loved the Fairhaven episodes. Those were some of my favorites.
In the 1900s, many ships were lost in the Bermuda Triangle. In the 24th century...
Where'd it come from?
We're already feeling its effects.
Will history repeat itself?
I'll have to ride it out.
An all-new Voyager. Can be programmed to create virtual worlds.
They're not people, they're holograms.
But what happens?
I'm late for a moonlight stroll.
When the computer's hard drive...
I got a boyfriend who malfunctions.
...goes haywire...
Would you like to kiss me?
Of course.
An all-new Voyager. Next Wednesday at 9, 8 Central on UPN.
Timothy, what are your overall thoughts on Star Trek We're Lost?
They had a lot of characters.
Yes.
That should have been the characters they were based on from the previous series.
Okay.
Don't have time to get into them there, but if you watched especially Next Generation and then watch Voyager, you're like, well, this character's that character, this character's that character, this character's that. Why didn't you just use those characters?
Well, you know, in DS9, they were going to have Ensign Ro in Major Kira's spot.
Yeah.
So there's an example.
Exactly. But again, they were trying to make it its own show.
Yep.
By stripping away some of the support that the previous shows had. In this case, they're well beyond the Federation.
Oh yeah.
They don't have the support of a massive government or military. Nobody's heard of the Federation.
They are themselves.
They can't stop at any planet to get the ship fixed. They have to fix it themselves.
Right.
They can't even replace their own energy stores. They can't use the replicator because it uses too much energy.
Enter Neelix.
Yes. Yeah. You know, to find them resources, energy, actual food. They're forced, oh my goodness, to eat real food. And so every place that they stop, you know, they're trading. Their money's no good anywhere.
Of course.
So
use money?
Yeah. So this is take Star Trek, and this is Star Trek Survivor. That's what it is. It's Star Trek Survivor.
I like that.
And some people do get kicked off the island along the way. Some by choice. Some, you know, minor spoiler, I won't give it all away. We find out one of the crew is a traitor and has always been a traitor.
Seska.
Well, I wasn't going to say that.
Sorry.
But when I got the results, her blood was lacking all the common Bajoran blood factors. Meaning?
The only conclusion we can reach is that she is not, in fact, Bajoran. It appears Seska has been genetically altered. My suspicion is she was born... Cardassian.
But it did have good episodes.
Yeah, it did.
It had a number of good the episodes with John Rhys Davies playing Da Vinci.
Oh,
wonderful
yes.
episodes.
Maravilloso.
What will you call it?
The Arm of Hephaestus.
The God of the Forge.
Every blacksmith who has ever swung a hammer will thank me for this creation.
Someone once said, all invention is but an extension of the body of man.
Do not think that just because I have enjoyed your visit today, that I am prepared to turn my workshop into a traveler's inn.
But I do have to admit, it didn't have the percentage of good episodes that previous series had.
I mean, there were bringbacks, definitely. Yeah. I mean, because we had a good handful of episodes with John DeLancey as mm-hmm. Q, once again.
What happened after you left Voyager?
Well, Q got away from me and rearranged the tectonic plates on Bozal Prime.
Did you punish him?
Well, I tried to get him to apologize to all 16 billion Bozellians, but he got angry and stopped talking to me.
So you gave in to him?
I told him he could shift as many continents as he liked, as long as no one got hurt.
You're not going to do your son any favors by indulging him. You'll need to make him understand that there are consequences to his actions.
Consequences? Kathy, I take it back. You are a genius.
DeLancey and Kate Mulgrew, good friends, longtime friends.
Yes, very good friends. And then in the Alpha Quadrant, where we are, we have a couple of Next Gen stars. We have Reginald Broccoli Barkley and Deanna Troi. They have this patient counselor type of relationship, but he's also trying to find a way to get Voyager home.
And he's the only one who believes they can be found.
Yes. And then even Riker shows up, I think, in a Q episode once or twice. Yeah. But there are some really fun episodes, and they do dive in a lot of Borg stuff. I mean, especially after Seven came on, because we got to now have a regeneration chamber on the ship. We got to have more Borg survivors. We got to have two different actresses play the Borg Queen in this show.
Inside the Unicomplex? Not feeling talkative. You and I don't need words to understand each other.
I mean, it gets a little much, but
two major disappointments is B'Elanna and Paris. They've been having Did they? They've been having a relationship for a couple of seasons.
Yeah.
It got really tight, and like, and yes, we're going to get married. We're going to get married. First actual wedding that we've had in a number of years on Star Trek.
Yep.
The wedding happens off screen.
Oh, you're right.
We don't see the wedding. We just see them in a shuttlecraft that says just married. It's like, you don't wind up your viewership and not pay off.
Yeah, yeah.
And the end, okay, no spoilers.
Oh, the finale
They do get back home.
It's like,
but it just stops there.
Yeah.
And I would have loved at least one more season, because Janeway broke a lot of Federation rules to get them back home. Neelix is not even a citizen of the Federation. Seven of Nine is still a Borg. The Doctor, they had a whole episode, number of episodes, like they did with Data, dealing with whether or not he's a life form worthy of rights. Mm. And this time they said, no, you're not. I would have liked one more episode to see how these people reintegrate or fail to reintegrate into the Federation when they get back.
It's true. And I mean, that's the problem I had with Voyager and Next Generation's finale, because they flash forward, they'd made the crew old, there's too much time travel going on, it's very confusing. And I mean, that's why I like DS9 so much, because they actually tried to say goodbye and end the story there. But yeah, no, I will say that there were some bits and characters where it was a little over the top, but all in all, I mean, I guess we're just gonna have to try to convert you again, Joe. But if you haven't seen Voyager, it's still a chapter, and it was a flagship show because it launched the channel, the short-lived channel UPN, and it was, you know, so that's something. It's something. I'm not saying if it's good or bad, but it's something. So give Voyager a chance.
They do, like the previous shows, over the course of the seven series, they do a good job of character development.
Yes, they do.
If the stories aren't always great, the character development is there.
The last thing I'll say is that, why'd you put Chakotay with Seven? I think he should have gone with Janeway. That's my last point. That's just my last point.
That's covered in an episode also.
That is. Yes, it is. So Voyager was big in many ways because, you know, we had the UPN thing, but then it also brought Star Trek into the 21st century. It ended in 2001. By this point, we hadn't had our last Next Gen film yet. So at this point, we have had 9 films and 5 different series. Five. So fans, although were thrilled, I bet we're suffering from a little bit of Star Trek fatigue. So when the producers were coming out saying, next series, guys, they said, okay, what do you got? And oh boy. So they said, you love Voyager, DS9, Next Gen. Yeah, we love that. The 24th century, yeah. Okay, forget those. Okay. Well, you love Kirk, though. Yeah, no, we love Kirk. Forget him, too. What's left? Before Kirk. This was the first prequel Star Trek show, Star Trek Enterprise. All right, so I'm going to be the first to say it here. You remember that imaginary hashtag, Justice for Animated? Justice for Enterprise. Enterprise came out 2001, lasting an unfortunate only 4 seasons. It was the first Star Trek series to get canceled ever since the original. And basically what their idea was is that we are set 150 years before Kirk and crew. We are the first people to go out. We are the first, quote, Starfleet crew to go out into deep space. And the intro was the first hated thing ever. Because although it's a beautiful idea to have the history of flight here, the theme song, oh boy, a pop song as the theme to Star Trek. What are you doing? What is wrong with you? Okay, Russell Watson's Where My Heart Will Take Me is a beautiful, fantastic, awesome, rockin' theme. I love this theme. It fits perfectly for Enterprise. Fun fact, was originally sung by Rod Stewart for the film Patch Adams. Did not know that. But the song is great. It is a lovely, lovely song. That's all I'm gonna say.
It's been a long road, getting from there to here. It's been a long time, but my time is finally near. 'Cause I've got faith of the heart, go where my heart will take me. I've got faith to believe I can do anything.
Back to the show. Joe, we'll go to you first. Star Trek Enterprise. Initially just called Enterprise because people thought, well, they know it's Star
right.
Trek.
Yeah.
We have, a like I said, the first crew out captained by Scott Bakula, so Dr. Sam Beckett of Quantum Leap.
Oh, boy.
Like I said, the goal of their show was to be 150 years before Kirk. We're learning things. We have a transporter. We don't want to use that thing. We don't know where we're going to rematerialize. The Vulcans are helping us out, sort of, but they're kind of having us on a tight leash. hi, we're humans, who are you? We're the Klingons, we're gonna beat you up. Stuff like that. What do you think of Star Trek Enterprise? Was it a wise decision, or do you think it was just...
I'm gonna go so far as to say that when that first came out, yep, I was extremely intrigued, just like Next Generation.
Really? Okay.
I really wanted to see what the writers did with the prequel.
Yep.
Because as people who are familiar with Star Trek know, there's a lot of novels out for mm-hmm. prequels to this.
Sure.
And other books all over the place as far as what they thought was going to happen. In fact, I resurrected one from my storage library.
Why'd you bring it? You should have brought it.
I think it's actually in my backpack out in the other room. So, but the thing is, I was really curious to see what they were going to do with it.
Yeah.
And I have to say that overall, although I didn't see as many of the episodes as I would have liked,
sure,
the ones I did see, I thoroughly enjoyed. Because it was interesting to see what the writers had in mind for the beginnings of the Federation, if you will.
Right.
And how they went about that.
And we got to see a lot of comebacks to the original. I mean, you know, we've had Vulcans throughout all of Star Trek, but the Vulcans were primary again. The Andorians, the famous blued antenna people, who would now...
The Andorians crippled us with their next shot. I've never seen one of their vessels maneuver like this one. Well, those barbarians have been talking peace. They've obviously been improving their warships.
Why would the Tellarites agree to let Earth mediate your dispute if they were planning this strike?
Perhaps you should ask them. I suggest you scan for our data recorder. It'll contain the sensor logs of the attack. We seem to keep running into each other, Captain. It's fortunate Enterprise was close by.
It's not a coincidence. We're carrying the Tellarite delegation.
They're aboard this ship.
These aren't the people who attacked you.
They may know who did. Tran! You're on my ship. You better keep them away from us. There will be bloodshed.
And now they move. Yeah. There we go. And you know, there were some great episodes. We had, like, albeit silly sometimes, but, you know, meeting the Klingons. We have a whole arc with the Romulans. That's much later. But silly episodes like our engineer Trip gets pregnant and.
When Enterprise makes first contact,
getting a chance to meet other species is our mission.
Expect.
You were there for 3 days and you couldn't restrain yourself.
The unexpected.
That is a nipple. I'm not sure congratulations are in order, but you're pregnant.
An all new Enterprise.
We also have a new alien race, the Denoblians. Our doctor, Dr. Phlox.
What is that?
It won't bite. It's called the triple. It was extremely difficult to acquire. They're outlawed on most worlds.
Why? Is it dangerous?
Oh, far from it. All it's capable of doing, really, is eating and breeding. The problem is they breed quite prodigiously. The only thing that keeps their population in check is the abundance of reptiles on their homeworld. Are you feeling all right, Ensign?
And, you know, trying to learn languages and stuff like that.
And I think our first spaceborne pet since Spock.
Yes, Porthos, our beagle. I love Porthos. He's so cute.
Where no dog has gone before.
Did you hear that? The doctor says you'll be fine. It's just a matter of time.
Well, Spot and was Livingston, the lionfish there in Picard's office? Yeah, yes. Something like that. But yeah, no, it's there are so many good parts to it. And I'll be honest, when my folks first watched Enterprise, I was a little young for it, but...
You were young for Enterprise?
I know. It was on late at night on this weird channel called UPN. I was fast asleep. Yeah. They said, oh my gosh, it's terrible. What is, this is not good. Because one of the main draws of Enterprise was, if that third series was called Star Trek The Next Generation, mm-hmm. Enterprise could be nicknamed Star Trek The Sext Generation. Because of a little thing we call decon.
Let's listen to this. That's the sound of people putting decon gel on themselves. Like, yes, I'm so glad that this is on your list.
Which involves, because these are the first guys out, we don't know what the planets we're landing on have, so the only way to disinfect ourselves is to literally strip down to our underwear and rub gel over each other. I'm not making this up.
Rub gel very slowly, very and sensually.
Yes!
Is this really necessary?
The others scan negative. You two, unfortunately, were exposed to a protocysteine spore. I've loaded the appropriate decon gel into compartment B.
Tell Mr. Mayweather to prepare to leave orbit.
How's the captain?
I'm treating his wound.
Will he be all right?
Eventually.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but aren't you just kind of an observer on this mission? I don't remember anyone telling me you were a member of Starfleet.
My Vulcan rank supersedes yours.
Apples and oranges. This is an Earth vessel. You're in no position to take command.
As soon as we're through here, I'll contact Ambassador Saval. He'll speak to your superiors, and I'm certain they'll support my authority in this situation.
You must really be proud of yourself. You can put an end to this mission while the captain's still unconscious in sick bay. You won't even have to look him in the eye.
Your precious cargo was stolen. Three Sulavan, perhaps more, were killed. And Captain Archer has been seriously wounded. It seems to me this mission has put an end to itself.
So,
and it was always either one of the male crew members treating a female crew member, or a female crew member treating a female crew member. I don't recall ever seeing a male crew member applying it to a male crew member.
So, all that put in mind, plus decon, Timothy, what do you think of Enterprise? In all seriousness.
I have to get my biases out of the way right up front.
Okay.
I love Scott Bakula as an actor.
Yes.
Yeah.
So the moment I saw he was going to be the captain, it's like, this is my show.
Yeah.
And that's how he agreed to be in it. He said if it was a prequel, I'm in.
Yeah. And I totally agree with you about the theme song.
Yes.
I mean, it sets the stage. I have a suspicion. I have no proof for it.
Okay.
But I have a suspicion that this is the show Gene Roddenberry wanted to make.
Really? Okay.
It's, you know, because it has the in the notes, and you see him on screen in the original series. There's a Commodore or Admiral April.
Yes.
Who was
Captain April? Yes.
And at least in some works, you hear Archer's name as one of the people who wrote the rules for Starfleet, and here we're getting to see him.
Right.
And I'm probably reading far too much into it, but the first line of that theme song, it's been a long road getting from there to here.
That
my dream will finally fly.
Yes. Yes.
You know.
Agreed.
So I have no proof, but that's my suspicion. If it's not true, I don't care. I like it. Now, as for the show itself, one of the few unfortunate parts is one of the big things about Star Trek we've been saying, all the other series, is the character development.
Sure.
Most of the character development is with Archer, T'Pol, and Trip.
Yeah.
And the others get short shrift.
They do.
And it's unfortunate. We see hints of very rich backgrounds for them.
Yep.
That don't really get explored. They
I mean, all I know is that, like, Malcolm likes pine.
Pineapple? That's my favorite.
How on earth did you know?
Pineapple, and Hoshi is... But she studied in Africa or something like that.
Yeah, she is their communications officer because they don't have a universal translator yet.
They built one.
She is making it.
Yeah.
She is programming it.
Which is brilliant.
In the meantime, she has to, on the fly, translate these languages.
When yeah.
The first time they meet Klingons in space.
Yeah.
She has to do diplomacy with this language that has three or four very different sub-languages. You know, and she has to do it on the fly.
Chloe O'Shannon wants to know, how do we talk to aliens? I think I'll give that one to my communications officer, Ensign Hoshi Sato.
Well, Chloe, that's a very good question. We use a device called the Universal Translator. It's like an alien dictionary with hundreds of languages programmed into it, and it can learn new languages very quickly, but it doesn't always work. And when that happens, it's up to me to try to translate. I'm sure I don't have to tell you, it can be really hard sometimes. One wrong word can mean the difference between saying, take my hand or take my life. So far, I've managed to do pretty well.
Thanks, Hoshi.
Yeah, no, and I totally agree. And I will say that it's nice to have these two, T'Pol and Trip, get together. I like yes. that bit.
But you want me back.
I don't know what you mean.
My mistake. See you around.
Wait, Trip. I want you to come back.
And I'll think about it.
Trip.
Days ago, I told Captain Hernandez I wanted to transfer back to Enterprise.
3 days ago.
I realized this is where I was meant to be, and that this thing between us isn't that big of a deal.
Agreed.
And Enterprise did have one thing going for it in its third season, the Zindi arc, which was huge. And in their fourth season is kind of where they started to go, but they sadly got canceled.
At least I remember hearing back in the day, one of the things that was going to be different is that it's so new that they won't have their technology to rely on. They won't have phasers. They won't have a transporter. They won't have replicators. All that went out the window very fast.
Right,
they
exactly.
They introduced all of them very quickly.
And having touchpads and stuff like that. We got to sadly wrap it up a little bit. But yeah.
But we get to see a lot of the backstory, like you said, of classic original series races that we hadn't seen their backstory before.
Exactly, yeah.
You know, the Andorians, the Tellarites, and a few others. We get to see a deep dive into Vulcan's back history. We get to see Sarek again. We get to see T'Pau as a young woman.
Yes.
And that is brilliant.
That really is. Yeah. And I mean, like, some great episodes as well, you know, having like the mirror universe a little bit. We brought that back into play. We'll be right back. combining it with an original series episode. And like I said with DS9, I'm going to be the black sheep. I love Enterprise's finale. They again tried to say goodbye despite having Riker and Troi.
They do. It's a night because it wraps it right up there, except Trip deserved a better send-off.
That's
true.
There
was no reason for him to leave the way he did.
You look very heroic.
Memorize this speech in grammar school. You wish you could tell them all that this alliance will give birth to the Federation.
I think I'm ready to talk to Captain Picard. I should have done it a long time ago.
So I guess we're through here.
I guess we are. Computer? End program.
Starship Enterprise. Its continuing mission:
to explore strange new worlds, to seek out new life and new civilizations,
to boldly go where no man has gone before.
Very true. So that is all we're going to do for Star Trek Part 1 here. I want to thank you both for coming on so much for the show. We're going to do a quick game called Who Are You? And so that's the intro there. And so we're going to roll the clip and you're going to tell me who it is and or what it is from.
Frank, he needs a black suit. There was a death in the family. My father, 85 years old, war hero. Yeah. There's a funeral this afternoon. Military funeral. Planes flying overhead. 21 gun salute. Frank needs to borrow a suit for a couple of hours.
All right. So that is the clip. And if you, what you have to tell me is who it is and/or what it is from. And if you get it right, you get points. If you get it wrong, we will send a box of tribbles to the Klingon Chancellor High Council and say it's from my friend Dylan. Sorry, Dylan. Mm-hmm. So, Joe, tell me quickly, who do you think that is and or what it is from?
I have to say I have no clue who that was.
Okay.
Now, as far as the video clip that it came from, I'm going to go with a cut scene from the original Top Gun.
Top Gun, okay.
Yeah, because honestly, I figured that was about the time they lost Goose in the epic, epic if that's the word you'd use.
Sure.
In the actual plane crash and loss of Goose.
All right, sounds good. Timothy, quickly, who do you think who that is?
Joe is so close. I have this one nailed.
Okay.
Joe is so close. That is actually not a clip that's ever been broadcast anywhere.
Okay.
It is a screen test of Robert De Niro for Godfather 4, because you see, he wants to get back into the Godfather films, and what it is Michael Corleone has been laying in front of that chair in Italy for years now. They just now found his body, and they're bringing it back to New York for a burial, and that's why his son needs to tuck. So, that's a screen test
screen
for
test.
De Niro.
Okay, that's a screen test for De Niro, and then Top Gun. Let's see if any of you are right.
See, that's
That's a pretty name.
Sadly, no. That is actually Christopher Walken from Catch Me If You Can.
Oh, I never saw that.
As Frank's father,
I
yes.
I saw that. Yeah.
So, unfortunately, we do have to send that package to the Klingon Empire. Sorry, Dylan. You're going to get some pretty nasty hate mail. Sorry about that. But I do want to thank you both for coming on. Hopefully, the two of you can come back for part two of Star Trek. And we will continue the summer of Star Trek on part two, the films. So until then, thank you both for coming on. Thank you to our magic and tech team. My name is Dan Saletti. Live long and prosper. And that's a wrap.